So, okay, I'm Alexander Burger, and I want to talk about PicoLisp application development. Just a moment. I want to focus this presentation a little bit, because otherwise I notice it's getting too long, and I want to concentrate only on two special effects on practical application development. So I will not talk about PicoLisp in general, or the basic of PicoLisp, or Lisp in general. I think it's not so important. I want to give an expression how to work in PicoLisp, or how I work personally, to get some feeling. It's not necessary to understand each and every detail what I'm doing. I just give examples. I think you can follow the examples. And it's, I think it's quite different from other Lisp or other GUI development. So I tried to get this in this presentation. A short outline. I don't have many slides. I must improvise. I have only some code snippets and parts. And so what I want to do is show the programming of the GUI and the components, and also how to connect them to the database. I must say that PicoLisp is unique in a certain way, because it contains a database. Database objects are first-class data types. They are primitives of the language. It's symbols, basically, special type of symbol, which is persistent if you handle them correctly. So it lends very much to do such database applications. For purpose of demonstration, I use a demo application, which is part of the PicoLisp distribution. This is all documented in the distribution or online documentation, so this is a proper way to start it. Just start the PicoLisp interpreter with this application file. As I said, I don't go too much into the details. And connecting the browser gives such a start page. I must say I have about 50 or 60 such applications in the world. They look all very similar. It's the style I developed for doing this kind of application. You can have another look and feel or another optics, but this is one I decided on. It has certain advantages for readability and for making certain aspects clear to the user. So please don't care too much about the look and feel. It's really very simple. Another reason is you can use the same GUI also in text browsers. It means it works also without CSS or JavaScript or cookies or whatever. It works in plain HTML too. It uses JavaScript and it uses HTML2. You mean chunks. Yes, it's important for speed, otherwise it's too slow. And what did I say? JavaScript is used, but not cookies. CSS is a little bit used. Okay, so if I log in, admin, everybody can know. It's a demo application, it's documented. And it's a very simple ERP system. It has orders. There's only one currently. Wait a minute, let's go over there a bit. That's too small. Okay, let's maximize it. It has orders, some items, and a lot of demo customers. And the basic principle is always for each class of database objects, you have one search dialog. Let's say searching for items. You have a menu item and a search dialog. And if you click on an item, you get the data for this entity. In the following, I want to concentrate on this customer supplier. It's an easy to understand concept. The search dialog is also quite straightforward. You can search for various attributes. Let's say all burgers living in Berlin. And of course, you can scroll quite fast. This is these chunked transfers you asked. In the following, I want to pick one customer. I pick this customer, Mr. Miller. So To understand this, we must also take a short look into the data model. This is the data model, the entity relation model of this application. I don't go too much in this now. Maybe we can talk about it later if there are questions. The customer is basically defined here. Customer has a number, a salutation, which is Mr. or something. It has a name and street and so on, normal things. The GUI is divided in some simple tabs. And so the normal work in such applications is you change all the time, you change the data model, and you are in this GUI. You're adding things and have things happening and modifying the data and the application. So the most important thing for me or for this kind of development is there's a single point of definition, I call it. If you have some action, if you define some action in the GUI or some logic or some behavior, it is all in one place. This means this function here, it's about 30 lines, this is a single function call, produces this page, everything you see. It produces the menu, and the menu is defined here. So this is the menu of this function. It's the menu of this application. It's also a function, as you see. Anything in PicoLisp is a function. That's maybe different to what Philip just showed us, where the GUI is defined as vectors or arrays. Or in PicoLisp, it's always a function. It means it always lives, it runs. If the page is loaded, if I click on this customer, if I click on this link or on this one, this code runs and produces a page in that moment on the fly. So I can change anything. Let's say I say new, I can make a big U. And if I reload this page, we have here the tab name is changed now. So it's very, very rapid to develop applications. No name. Okay, so let's do some experimentation and let's extend this GUI. I add another tab. I make an empty tab. So this is an empty tab, nothing in there. I could write some HTML things like, let's say, a header. Sorry? The unquote? Okay, this is it's a read macro. It's used for localization. If I go to the home page, if I change to some language, let's say Japanese, customer supplier, it says Namae here. So this is because this name is a symbol. Actually, in PicoLisp, there are no strings. There are only symbols. These are symbols. And OK, it cannot display kanji here. And the symbol's value is the translation. It's very easy. So if I switch the locale, OK, it's the same in German. This was not so clever. Let's take address. It says adresse. So the comma means this is a string to be translated. Okay. I think you get the idea. These HTML functions make a more complicated thing. Let's say unordered list. I can put a class here, a class or a lot of styles, a list of styles, or there are many things possible. Let's say It's a mega class. I know this is defined in the CSS. Here, this one is a style. So I get a red header. Doesn't matter. Okay, this didn't work because here I forgot this. So we have nil. Now we have an unordered list. These are the primitive HTML functions. There are lots of them. But usually you're not interested in low-level HTML stuff, but in components which do something with the data and the database or have some behavior or some internal logic. So and this is done by a single function. It is called GUI. It's it takes a list of classes and optional other arguments. And when this function runs, it produces proper HTML to appear on the screen, and also on the server some virtual object which implements the behavior of the GUI on the server. So I must say the most of the logic and the things running happen on the server. The browser is a kind of stupid GUI, a dump terminal, kind of. So the GUI function is the basic, the main driving vehicle. Let's take some. I insert a text field. I use this grid. It makes a two-column alignment of the data, and now I defined a text field with a width of 30. So. You see, I cannot enter any information. I must first click on Edit. I go to English again. I have here some. I need a mouse. Ah, I'm stupid, sorry. No, it's okay, it's okay. You need to click on Edit. This is also a convention in this application because some applications we have up to 30, 40 users, and they should not interfere on the operating on the same object. So there's a kind of locking mechanism. I will show this later using two browsers. But if you click on this field, it's getting green, and now you can enter some data. I told you that there are virtual components on the server. So basically here I'm on the client, and remotely this is the server. This is the server running on a Unix machine. The client is usually a Windows machine. And with show I can actually look at this object. This is the object which implements the whole form. So this is the form at the moment. It has a text field with this value, which is also, okay, the first component is the edit button. Or I can take a look at our text field. It must be the four, the last one. No, it's the last one. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. This one. This is our text field. It is enabled, it is changeable, it has an internal index and a width of 30. And there's a link back to the home object. So it's a kind of special structure which handles the whole logic of the GUI. I can also ask for this value. If I look at the fourth element, has this value. If I change this. It's changed. Okay, great. A more advanced field is maybe a number field. I make it smaller, only 10. Test text field, okay. So now we have a number field. If I put in something, it complains, numeric input expected. And if I put a proper number, it accepts. And if I look at the value, it is a number, it's not a string. No, actually, this is it's all running without JavaScript. It has the same behavior, but JavaScript speeds it up. I think in this case, it is not involved, because done refreshes the page anyway. Not in this case. Another subclass of date field would be a number field would be a date field. So if I put something here, I didn't reload yet, sorry. So it expands to a date and complains if it's not a valid date. And it also does things like localization, or for example, this is now it's the American 22. If I just put a day, it expands to the current month and year. That's why it behaves this way. If we go to once again to the German locale, then you'll see it makes the opposite arrangement of day and month. Sorry, I must go to English again better. Okay, so these are primitive fields. What is often needed is a button. I have prepared an example. So, a button is also called created by the GUI function, but it is of class button. But this button does nothing yet. So what the button also takes is an expression, an arbitrary expression. Make it a little bit vertical. For example, if I do something like message hello world, and you look at this, you see it's printing something to standard error. If I make it a JavaScript button, it should go, it should be more smooth. It's going more smooth, no? More typical for an application is not printing something to standard error, but to put a dialogue or something. So there are lots of predefined dialogues, for example, a node. A node is simply this. So the idea of dialogues in PicoLisp is a little bit strange because of the requirement not to be dependent on JavaScript. Dialogues always pop up as small forms. The same is here. If you remember, if I click here, I get the big search dialog. Let's do it again. And the same dialog appears also here, select, in a smaller form. So this is a dialog. This is a search dialog. Here I also can do a new, create a new object. Or cancel, it disappears. The same dialog here doesn't have a cancel button. Here it's really a form. It's okay. There's some allocation, of course. I mean, this page is red. If it's not a JavaScript button, okay, only a button or a link will, a get or a post will refresh this page. And in case of a JS button like this one, which doesn't make sense now because it pops up a dialog anyway, but in case of a JS button, nothing is reloaded. Only the virtual components in the form on the server execute their state. Yes. Yes. It's the server is a forking server. What I started in the beginning on the command line is a kind of stub, a kind of controlling parent process, and each time you connect a browser, it forks. It's just only a small process, only less than 1 megabyte, 300 kilobytes, and it forks, and then you have maybe 10, 20, 100 clients running each its own process, its own environment, its own GUI components, of course, and they communicate via the parent with pipes to synchronize the database state and such things. Yes. Mm-hmm. The parent is completely stupid. It just manages the communication. So, okay, I started with a node. A node just pops up a simple alert. And if you want to make some branching in the GUI, some decisions or so, you can make an ask. You can say ask. Are you all right? And then maybe say, let's keep the parents balanced. I don't like par edit. okay, if I press this button now, it says, are you all right? If I say no, nothing happens. And if I say yes, it says good to hear. It pops up another alert. Mm-hmm. Yeah, no problem. I'm glad about questions because I'm not sure if it's too fast. No, it's all implemented. I know every byte in this system. There is no library involved. Nothing at all. Yes, there are coroutines, actually, not continuations, coroutines, but they are not used here. They are not used here because the child process is persistent. It's here. We have here, it has a PID. Yes, it stays there. It has all the state. Mm-hmm. Yes, if you log out, it is, you can see here, there's a timeout. We have a timeout 1 hour by default. And if you log out, now it says 18:36. And now it says 15:42, only 5 minutes. So if the user logs out and goes home, the child process terminates after 5 minutes. And if he's logged in and doesn't log out, it stays 1 hour. It's configurable. But 1 hour is usually enough. Because many people forget to log out, and it's not good if the resources are taken too long. So back to our GUI components. I have not enough screen space here. So I want to show a more complex dialogue, a real dialogue. What can we throw away? So here we have a self-made dialogue. The alerts and asks, they were same style. We can look at it. Ask is basically an alert which spans the string, are you all right, and makes two buttons, yes button and no button. So you see, the nice thing is, because everything is a function, you can nest all these things. You can have HTML code like the span, but also components like this yes button, which creates a GUI in turn. So there's no need to generate anything somewhere in XML files, what Florian complained, or you have only one place where you program, only this place. You don't need to define any resources or any functions or something off-stream. You concentrate on this place and do everything the application demands in this situation, in this place. So here we made a dialogue. Here, this is a dialogue. This NIL is not a style, it takes an environment to pass in some data if necessary. Here it's not needed. So it makes a header, HTML header, and makes also two buttons. We could, for example, also make a text field here. Okay, let's first take a look at this dialogue before I modify it. still in the VI here. And I made a parenthesis wrong. Wait a minute. Parents is good, yeah. Par edit. It's worse for me. I have the habit of editing here and there and not in between at the same time. And then par edit messes this all up. So this is our self-made dialogue. Okay, I just want to show how it's possible. You could make a text field. The columns and has a label. So now we have a text field here. No big thing. And all these fields are easy to modify. This date field or this text field is just a text field, but if you look at more complex examples, you see there are more classes involved. These are called prefix classes in PicoLisp. It's basically it's a mix-ins. So if you take this button again, you remember if you are not in edit mode, this button is not pressable. But these buttons are. How does it work? So if I give a prefix class of rid, get rid of something, get rid of the log maybe. This button is enabled also if you're not in edit mode. Or another button, I made a today button, I saw it off again. This is a button which is called today, and which takes as an expression to execute when pressed, takes the command to set the field, the previous field, this is field minus one, this is this date field, to today. So if I say today, we get today in this field. So the fields can interoperate. And this is an important point. Just for a very short look, I don't want to explore too much on this. This is a typical case. This is the order form. If you press this button, you get a search dialog for articles. If you add this article, it expands to this price. You see we have here still 5, 8, 9. If I take 10 of these articles, you saw it expanded. It calculated this and it calculated this. So the whole form is interacting. Also, if you scroll these data, or if you exchange lines, you can. This is called a bubble button. It bubbles up a line, or you can delete. You can delete lines. All these interactions are implemented in this style, in this way. Back to our customer. Okay, and one more example of a simple interaction is I make a very simple calculator. We define three fields. One plain number field without anything, number field, and another number field, and a view field. A view field is a locked field which is not editable and which displays a value, in this case, the sum of the two fields before it. By name, yes, okay, yeah. Let me. I show you, just a moment. In this example, it's a good case. If I put 3 and 4 here, we get 7. Instead of field minus 2, I can say field num 1. You can just write it here. Number 2. So a GUI component can have a name. Okay, so.
What kind of names do they get if you don't give them names?
Then there is no name, and referring to them by name is an error. I think it complains.
Mm-hmm.
the form injection. What do you mean with injection?
When you type the number in that box, press done. When you re-display the form, you need to put all the other numbers back in that right box.
Yes. In this case, I come to this. In this case, if you leave this form, all data are gone, because we made only dump text fields until now. It's a good question, because I think it's anyway on my schedule. Yes, it was later, but if I want to keep these data, I say it's a var field, and I give a variable. Let's call it A. And this one, it's also a var num field, and it takes B. If I refresh and say 1, 1, 1, 2, 2, 2, and A has 1, 1, 1, and B has 2, 2, 2, and yeah, that's all. So now it's persistent. It's persistent across the session only. The typical case is what you see here. It's not a var field, but ER, entity relation fields, and they are connected to entities, to relations of objects in the database. I show this later. One more important component is a chart. It's a scrollable area. We saw this in the search dialogues or also in this order form. A chart is very easy to make because it's needed so often. So, okay, not so easy, but let's take a look at it. Do I have the parents right? Seems so. So now we have a chart. And what did we do? What did I do? This defines a virtual component of a chart. We can take a look at here. This is the last chart. It's also an object which holds all the information about this two-dimensional fields. This defines three headers, also with styles or with other information in the car. A flag, a text, and a number. Flag, text, and number. And then we define with GUI recursively more components. So, this number is this is a key that the runtime system knows this field belongs to a chart. So it's very simple. The last chart defined. You see, the chart is kind of standalone here, but and making a table is not part of the chart. The table is just the rectangular alignment. What counts is only this number. If you give a GUI component instead of this name we had before, if you give a number, this component knows it belongs to a chart and behaves accordingly. And we define five components: a checkbox, a text field, a number field, and these two standard buttons, the bubble button I told you about and the delete row button. So now you can write something here. And the value of this thing is, of course, a nested list, a list of lists. So, yeah, so let's go to the database connectivity. Similar to this var field, we have ER fields, and for this I should go back to the entity relation definition. It simply specifies that this field is connected to the number property of the object which is in the home, is the top form, which is in the current form. So if we take a look at this object, it's a customer with number 3 and name Miller and so on. If I modify the name, it's immediately stored in the database. And we can extend the application a little bit. Let's put a birthday. I want to put a birthday to this. I just add one line to the data model of the customer, which says it's born, it's of type date. And we still have our date field here. So I say entity relation date field connected to the born property. Okay, but one thing, if I modify the data model, I must reload it. Usually for safety, I stop the application once and start it new. So if we go to our customer supplier again, now it's called Miller 22. If I put a date here, it has a new property. This custom has a new property, which is his birth date. It's not very clear from this number. Numbers are represented as days since zero, since Christ was born. So this we have 700,000 days now. But the date can be expanded here. If fields, if a field refers to another object, for example, the salutation is an own entity. You can see the salutations here, and there is something like Mr., and it has a sex, and it has a greeting used in printing. And so each customer or supplier has a salutation object. I can change it here, let's say to Herr. If I look at this object, now it's Herr, no, it's another one. One important thing also in this application is I can always go back. The back button of the browser is supported. This is almost nowhere the case today, but people need it. They use it all the time. You can even go, let's say you open a search dialog for orders and then you say, oh, I don't want it. And just go back, and you're back where you are. This is quite a tricky thing. One important thing is this post redirect get to get because otherwise the browser complains if you go back to a posted page. And then of course the state in the server is kept for each form, and it has a history for each form. For the last 99 versions of this form. And if you go back, it is detected. I think you can see it. If yes, it's always the whole form, except for these JavaScript, for these JS fields. If it's a JS field, no, even then, no, sorry, not even then, the whole, not the layout and not the HTML, but all fields are posted and get. It is necessary because there may be cross relations. If you modify one thing, it has dependencies on other things. So it's always posted all and fetched back. Yes, if you do a modification here on the GUI, if I write something and leave this field, then in this moment, it is already committed to the database. So other users will see this. I want to show this. Maybe we can do this now. It's a problem of screen space here. Let's start again. I start here this browser. Okay, then let's take my favorite W3M browser. So put it. Not TW3M? W3M? No, it's FWVM. FBWM. So, okay. Now I connect it to this application and I connect again here. So, here I log in as admin. And here, I take another user. One feature is in this application, if two users from the same IP address log in with the same name, the first one is thrown out, because it assumes it's the same user logging in again, and to keep resources down. So I use two different users. Let's go to our customer again. And here also, I must somehow make it big. How can I do it? Okay, so you see it works the same. Searching or even scrolling without any JavaScript or anything. So I go to this Mr. Miller again. And the tabs are a little bit poor, looks like this, without any CSS, but you can use it. It's actually quite useful if you have only a SSH connection or so to some machine. You can start a browser there and test the application. So if I lock this page here to work on it, if I try the same here, I get currently edited by some other user. And if I succeed and try it here, so this is this kind of locking mechanism. And you're done. That's why I have the time out. Yes, I had this problem. Yeah, must wait an hour. One common case is people close their browser and didn't want to. And then the session is gone, they cannot get back. This is also one reason why logging in with the same name again kills the previous session. So if you notice, I forgot to log out, just log in again and log out, and then it's terminated. Kind of personal taste, maybe. Cookies would be possible. The session is completely URL-based. You see there's a session ID. And the port number, it's all encoded in the URL. Do you mind the change history for this back button in the browser? It's had nothing to do with the database. Yes. Exactly. No, the database is not changed back. If you go back to an old page, you see an old state. If you commit this state, then you commit the old state. This cannot be handled. It is committed, but if he goes back to an old page and sees an old state of data, and then says edit and save. Okay, if he says edit, it's refreshed, and it's also he gets the current state. This is also not a problem. The problem is actually if you use tabs, browser tabs. Because browser tabs, I use them quite often, but you must be careful. If you have two tabs on the same object, you can do something, some harm. It's your responsibility. You must have it in access. But I'm not sure what could happen. I recommend people not to do this. What's done often is just look at other objects, like here. I have a salutation, a link to a salutation, so I can click on this and inspect this, and so on. This pencil is quite important, or quite used quite often. You see in the order, the customer is here, or the items. So you can inspect things, and don't put your main focus on them. The same goes with reports. This is a typical case. If you have a very long report and you scroll here, then it's very convenient to just to click on the second tab, and you can go down the report. Where is it here? And don't lose the context. It's just convenience. Okay. I don't know what's. I have some more points, but a kind of repetitions what I already told. What you also can do here in this case, in such a search dialog, if you press new, let's say I want to assign a new salutation to this customer, which doesn't exist yet. I search for it. If I search for it and it doesn't exist, so you say new. And then you can close this customer or go to the salutation. This is a new one. And if you go back to the customer, okay, we can try the back button here. It has a new salutation. So the back button reloads it properly. Just tabs don't do it. If you switch between tabs, the browser sends no kind of event to the server, so this cannot be handled. Another very common. Okay, I want to show one more thing. I think I'll leave this one. And I want to show a little bit more complicated field interaction. So let's go to the address. And we have a zip number and a city name. So it would be nice if you enter a new zip number, if the city would be cleared. So how can we do this? I go to the address tab, and I add a change prefix. Let's make a little bit manually. So here I can put a change. In this case, it's a function. I prepared it. So a simple function taking one argument and which clears the next field. We saw this already in a similar form. So yes, the function is also just a list. And it's directly executable in this form. Yes, I want to reload this. I already changed this one. No, it cleared this field. This is what we wanted. And what's also important for such address fields is to have a context-sensitive output. If I put some zip number, like, and I type something here, I would like to have the corresponding zip numbers be presented, proposed. So to do this, I modify the city field. Put it a little bit vertical to have it on the screen. This can be done with a hint property, with a hint prefix. Hint gives the user some hint. And hint can be actually any expression. So I prepared some complex one. It's also a function which queries the database. Querying the database with the name of the city input so far. I think I shouldn't go too much into detail. It's a select on the database with zip number and city name. So nothing changed here, but if I start to type something, it proposes. What is Kassel? 5-5. I'm not Kassel, Bonn or St. Augustin. Hm? 5-3-1-2-9. Maybe not. It's Bonn. Ah, yeah. Proposing one. If I type an O or an N or a B, it proposes Bonn. Yeah, quod erat demonstrandum. I think that these examples, these are the examples I wanted to show. So, yeah, the change, this one. So, okay, I think it's clear, all these mix-ins or prefixes go one-to-one with the arguments. So this is taken by text field, and this is a change, the change function. It just says clear the previous field. In case, okay. Mm-hmm. Oh, I don't have it here. Oh, I didn't start in debug mode. Once more. So this is a change class. Define method DM, yes, and it overrides two messages, two methods, set and the val. In case of set, it remembers the old value, and if the value is taken later, it compares the old value with the new value, and if it's different, it assumes it was changed and then calls this. Here I call the new function. This here, this is the T method is it's a kind of not a constructor, it's an initializer called implicitly, and it's passed a function. And this function is remembered in the object, and then it passes all other arguments to the following classes for initialization. So it remembers the function, and then it handles set and val. So okay, I think that's all I can remember. I think it's useful to know. Yes. Yes. Mm-hmm. It's as I said. It's based on symbols. You know, a symbol in Lisp is something like this. And if a symbol, let me pick one. Let's go to the customer again. This is actually a symbol. If you look at the customers, you see we get all these customers. It's always this is actually a plain, very normal symbol in Lisp, but it has a special behavior. You cannot create it like another symbol by interning. You must call new. If you call new with some special arguments, okay, let's do it. Let's make a new customer. It's empty now. I can put this object a number. Not name. Name, so I think I must copy this. So it is created only explicitly, and at that moment it resides as a normal symbol in memory, but it has a special name. The first part specifies a file where these types of objects reside in, and the second number or second item is actually base 64 encoded, specifies the offset of this object in this file. And the file is divided in blocks, varying sizes, and the object is stored in a kind of serialized form in these blocks, and if it's getting bigger, many blocks are chained again for a single object. So there's no limit to the size of an object. Mm-hmm. Yes. There's one very important object is called DB database, object number one. And this has as a tree the whole database. So if you look at this, you have, for example, for all the subclasses, we have sub-databases. And these are B-trees. For example, the B-trees for the name. And you can navigate now through this database. Now I'm at the customer. I go to the salutation. And Yes. Yes, you get holes. Actually, there's a garbage collector for the database, which may take some time. I run it usually in the night. For normal applications with a few million objects, it's a few minutes. But I had also one application with a billion objects, and it took more than one day to do the garbage collection. But anyway, the space is collected in a free list and reused. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Don't change the location, the place. Mm-hmm. This would be fatal because the name is also the identity of this object. Mm-hmm. It's cached by the operating system, the write buffer cache. I don't do anything. I use a normal pwrite, seek and write as an atomic operation. The whole database commit is quite involved because it involves, in addition to the locking we saw with this button, which is a user-level locking, it involves a low-level FCNTL locking. In the moment if there's a transaction is committed, it is locked on the lowest level. There's even read accesses are prohibited. In this case, you saw we could also read the database. And then the whole transaction is written and is also communicated to all other running processes connected to this single parent. So all users using this database see the changes immediately. In the case of commit, the whole file is locked. There's a function, it's called lock, where you can specify to lock only a single symbol. But it's actually, of course, it is used for this GUI feature, for the explicit lock of this object. But the hard lock used internally locks actually only byte one of the first file, but it's interpreted by all processes they try to gain this, to get the same lock and don't get it, so it's protected. Mm-hmm. Yes. It's anyway, it's only, it's not mandatory locking in POSIX. No, the garbage collector, actually you mean the kind of compaction or sowas? Yes, it's never cleaned up. It's not cleaned up. If it's, how was it? No, I think, maybe if it's written, no, it's not. It stays fragmented. So it's wise, if you specify the database, it's wise to estimate the kind of reasonable size. This specifies the files to use. And you see, these are these files. And you can specify the block size. It's an encoded form of here it's written. It means the index, this name index, for example, has its own file, and it uses a block size of 1024. So if you have, you can optimize quite a lot if you don't make the blocks too big, but also not too small. No, it just Actually, it deletes the objects. So, for example, if I delete this object, I stopped it here. Delete customer, and I say yes. Now it appears in brackets. So it's actually deleted now. If I search for this, I must remember the ID. Wait a minute. Because it's kind of gone, not completely. This is object 2.3, no? But you see it has a T property. This means it is deleted. Actually, it's the application never deletes anything. For example, it may be referred to from an order. If you have an order, it's this one, actually. Good example. This order refers to this Miller 2.2.3.3. The order must still exist in the database for documentation purposes. But if you look at this object, it is in brackets. And the garbage collector is a normal mark and sweep collector, just on database object. It goes through the database, and if this customer is not referred anywhere, only then it is physically removed from the block file and the blocks are recycled. There must be programmed explicitly. For example, there's a property in the order. And if I delete the number or the date, no, what was it, the order? Ah, so yeah, it's the order, of course. I just deleted all the positions. If I try to remove the date, I cannot. Input required. This is a consequence of this need property. It's used quite seldom. Most constraints are implemented as check methods explicitly, like this one. This class of order, this class has a check method. For example, I can't even input it now, but it would complain there is no date if I try to print it. What is here? I'm still alive. Okay, it complains here, so I must put a date. No, something hanging. What did I do? What else is checked? If there's no customer, this is not a hard condition because the user can input a customer or not. If I delete the customer and then try to print, it says can't print, no customer. So this is not a low-level constraint in the database, it's in the GUI in this case. So you check depending on the situation. In the beginning, you don't need a customer. If you make a new order, you don't have a customer. Or maybe it depends on other fields. If you have a special type of customer, let's say on the European market, then there are special checks performed. If I look at a real application, I have a lot of checks here, which are quite involved sometimes. So it's a soft constraint, which must be called explicitly. This print button we saw in the order. This is this print, this PDF button. It does a check. So I know if I want to print this order, I must check for certain things. So it is checked, and then it displays this note if it's not satisfied. Okay. Time is up. Some more questions? Okay. Yes, of course. You can. It depends. I don't have some SQL interface or something. Import and export is done often with some external format. The 64-bit version can call any C function, so it's very easy to call also external database code if needed. But then you have all these problems with synchronization between the clients and consistency and so. I didn't investigate it really. Yeah, okay. Thank you.